In a small village in southern Uganda, outside a town called Embarara, sits the house of a Josephine Nemaya.
Call me Mama.
An infection has disfigured her feet, and the pain would be completely debilitating if it wasn't for this red liquid the nurses just delivered to her.
Then get the syringe and draw.
It's the same stuff that's delivered through IV pumps in American hospitals, morphine. But here, it's taken by mouth, and it comes in recycled water bottles. Morphine is also what helped this man. Patrick Sabwe used to be a fisherman, but now confined to his shack because he has AIDS and the painful Kaposi sarcoma rash that often accompanies the infection. Helen Burungi, a healthcare worker, has been taking care of Patrick for months, bringing him morphine.
Was Patrick able to walk before he had morphine?
No, he couldn't. They brought him in a wheelchair. So after like 2 weeks on morphine, he started walking.
That may sound unremarkable, but in Uganda and many other countries, it's nothing short of a miracle. The fact is, 80% of the world's population lives in countries with little or no access to morphine. That's roughly 5 billion people making do with just 5% of the global supply. Compare that with a handful of wealthy nations, including the U.S., with just 5% of the world's population. They consume 95% of the morphine. Which means, for millions, scenes like this are all too common. These are images the student journalists from the University of British Columbia filmed during another reporting trip to India, where morphine is hard to get.
I've spoken to many patients who told me that they wanted to commit suicide because the pain was simply unbearable.
Diedrich Lohmann is a senior researcher with Human Rights Watch, an international organization widely known for fighting torture, among other things, which has recently taken up the issue of global pain.
It's quite a leap from campaigning about torture to campaigning about a drug like morphine, isn't it?
Right. When we started working on this, I was actually struck by the parallels you see in the testimony you get from kind of your traditional torture victim and someone who has cancer pain that is not relieved. Your typical torture victim will sign a confession and the torture ends. The patient with pain doesn't have that option.
Surprisingly, Lohmann says the shortage isn't about money. Morphine is easy to produce, and it's cheap, just pennies a dose. The problem is where it comes from. Here, the same kind of poppy field that produces morphine's illicit cousin, heroin.
Many countries have become so zealous in trying to limit access to controlled substances that their regulations have started interfering with the availability of these substances for medical purposes. You could call them collateral damage of the war on drugs.
So people are suffering terribly because of bureaucracy.
Essentially, yes.
You know, it's a God-given answer to pain, but we've abused it, and so it's scarce for the people in pain.
Anne Merriman is working to cut through the bureaucracy and get morphine to the people who need it. She's a doctor and former nun from Liverpool, who came to Uganda as a medical missionary 2 decades ago and said she simply wouldn't stand for what she saw.
I saw the patients with terrible diseases, terrible ENT cancers, and all they had was, the strongest they had was codeine, and you could only have that if you could afford it.
She campaigned for laws making access to morphine a basic right, but there was still the challenge of how to get prescriptions for this controlled narcotic written in a country with very few doctors.
So the laws were so rigid that access to morphine was impossible.
So Dr. Jack Jagwe, a longtime Ugandan health ministry official, worked with Dr. Merriman to come up with a creative solution around the doctor shortage.
So we convinced the government that let us amend the law to allow nurses to be able to prescribed morphine.
So that was a big thing. That was the first, we were the first country to get that allowed. Yeah.
The first country.
Mm.
And that was in the world.
Now specialized nurses in Uganda are trained on how to diagnose which patients need morphine and how to administer the drug. Helen Burungi is one of close to 100 nurses and clinicians who've been trained so far. She makes half a dozen visits a day to patients in their homes, which often are hidden deep inside slums like this one.
Jackie.
Jacqueline Sonia has cancer. She takes 4 doses of the morphine liquid every day.
Now that she has the morphine, the pain is limited. Yesterday, it was much better. She managed to clean the house and wash some clothes.
Perhaps the most stark medical transformation is evident here at the country's only hospital burn unit. Just listen. Not a peep, not a single cry of pain.
The reality is, without morphine, there's a limit to how much you can really support somebody who's in severe physical pain.
Dr. Moira Long is the first head of palliative care at Mulago Hospital, and she took us around to meet some of the patients. Patients like Richard Sabandeki, who just days before was badly burned in a house fire.
I mean, burns cause a very severe pain problem, and particularly somebody like Richard, who has burns affecting a large part of his body, the pain will be very bad. Yeah. So in many ways what we're doing is we're bringing hope, and we're bringing relief, and we're bringing a very human-to-human sense of compassion and care.
Compassion and care are being handed out along with the morphine.
The patient is into this house down here.
Nurse Betty B. Fabusa heard about a sick man who was homeless, sleeping in the bush, abandoned by his family.
They thought this disease is contagious, and no one wished to be with him.
Betty gave him morphine, but she also collected money to build the man this mud hut. It turned out that the patient, Kasaija Karabi, had advanced cancer.
So current is taking 2 meals every after 4 hours and then 4 meals at night.
When Betty's not around, the only one left to administer the medicine is his young son, Fred.
Is Fred the only one that's caring for him?
Yes, he's the only one, and he's the only child he has.
The night after the students met Kasaija and his son Fred, the father died. The women of the village came out to wrap the body and prepare it for a traditional burial. Thanks to morphine, Fred didn't have to see his father suffer in his final moments, a small victory in the war on pain, which Dietrich Lohmann of Human Rights Watch hopes is just one of many yet to come.
A government that is willing to make rational changes to its drug regulations can actually make a tremendous amount of progress without necessarily investing an enormous amount of money. Someone who is dying of cancer should not have to unnecessarily suffer from severe pain. We all agree on that.